then, there will be great tribulation such as has not been from the beginning of the world until now, no, and never will be. And if those days had not been cut short, no human being would be saved. But, for the sake of the elect, those days will be cut short. Then if anyone says to you, look, here is the Christ, for there he is, do not believe.
Refined in flame, servant of the Most High, unabashed and unafraid. I am Christopher Manti, and this is Frontline.
Welcome back, my friends. I'm Christopher Manti. This is Frontline, radio and television throughout the world via the internet. And I welcome you. Thank you for joining me here. This is the 8th episode of this brand new program here on CMV TV. Or if you're watching me in the archives, welcome. Thank you for checking me out and this program. Today is the 23rd of February. 2015. So February comes to a close here on Frontline with never-ending flurry of activity. It seems our world is swirling in a stormy state. So I thank you for weathering it here. Hopefully you can learn something and we can learn from each other. As always, feel free to send emails through the CMV TV site or go to my YouTube channel at Manti7000 or Wings of the Eagle, wherever you end up, ChristopherManti.com, all that good stuff. Shoot me a line, and I'll answer any question that you have or concern. And hopefully before too long here, we'll have more of an interactivity on the program, but you can always pop in right now if you're on Twitter or Facebook or create a login right below. If you're watching me live, right below my face, there's an area there for chat interaction. So just log in there again with your social media credentials or create an account, and then you can chat with me or other listeners. Okay, so please feel free to do that. But I understand a lot of people who view this or listen will be after the fact, so you don't get to do that. All right, that is the way it is. So again, welcome. I just want to give glory to the Father because we do this for Him. I do this for the glory of Jesus Christ throughout the world. And I hope that He uses me. Father in heaven, I pray that You do use me this day, that Your word may go forth and not return void. We ask You to keep Your promises, Lord. You know, we know that You love us and that You sent the only begotten Son, Yeshua, to die in our place. For we all have fallen short and we all are sinners. But through You we are redeemed. And we pray to become spotless and ready for Your return when we will rule with You for 1,000 years and for eternity. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, folks. Once again, it is on in this world. I don't know if you rely on me for any type of news or information or just biblical exposition, but there's so much going on nowadays that it's easy to miss. For example, well, just as a rough overview today, what I want to talk about is some of the things you may not be aware of, the jihadi threats to the West. There are specific threats to locations, and I want to go over those, so just to be on guard if you're in those places. Why is it that we're so afraid to call a spade in our governments of the West, particularly the United States, because that's where I am? We have an answer to that, parts even from the horse's mouth, so to speak. What is Turkey doing militarily in Syria? What is Iran doing all over the place? We are also going to play a video called Arab Spring, the Coming Caliphate. And it's very, very interesting, especially since it's 4 years old now, before all this Arab Spring really took off. So it's prophetic in that way. But you'll see how understanding is being released, is being unsealed. The book of Daniel is the key to all this, and that's how God set it up. And that's why it was sealed 2,500 years ago. So by necessity, it would not be understood, regardless of how much we, or how good of an effort we gave, the church, I mean, to understand it all, we could not until the time of the end. So the closer we get to it, the more understanding there will be of it and of prophecy in general, therefore. So anyway, the Arab Spring Coming Caliphate is a mini, just about 10-minute video. There's also another one called Islamic Beast Attributes that if I feel like showing, I will show. And something just wonderful that will make your day, I hope, is something that I earnestly want to pray for here in my land or any land ever, you know, wherever in the earth, but particularly in the West, because we don't see such things. It's thousands of Egyptian Christians shouting Yeshua, Yeshua, Yeshua over and over and over. It's a giant... It's a church service. It's cut into the side of a mountain. That's how we have to do it in the other in the Muslim lands. Okay, so I hope that will edify you and bring you joy, like it does to me. I will show that a little later. And if I'm forgetting something, I don't think so. That should get us through Psalm 74, perhaps. That came to my mind yesterday to point out how this clear and present situation with Islam, I hate to keep talking about it, but it's the point is this is what God is using to bring about the events that will bring the kingdom of God to the earth. So... I just lost my train of thought there. Pardon me. Anyways, that's what we're going to be talking about. Violent extremism said that. Why do we say violent extremism instead of a lot Islamic terror? And then, of course, the videos that I mentioned. So we are going to have a good time, as always. Oh, Psalm 74. That's what I meant. Right. If you don't think Islam is in the Bible, then I direct you there and we'll go over that. I want to make a note of it now so I don't forget. Because I'm prone to forgetting these things, believe it or not. So please do tune in and tell all your friends. Please share this. This is my corner of ministry where I've been gifted to do certain things in broadcasting over the years, and nothing felt... satisfying ultimately instead of this is purely gospel centric. We'll talk about the Lord and the Word of God and the coming events and the cross, of course, and the days of old and anything you want. But everything else falls short. You know, we could talk about elections and politics and entertainment, you know, the culture at large. That's all well and good. But God has been preparing me and will prepare you in ordering your mind, setting your mind right in the priorities, and having the mind of Christ, as Paul would say, the mind of Messiah, to put things in the right order. And frankly, at the time I go to bed at night, I don't have a lot of time for things that I used to, and that's good. That's good. Love, joy, and peace, patience, goodness, kindness, meekness, faithfulness, self-control, right? That's what we want to exude all the time. And even though we might feel like getting angry or getting revenge or even being violent to the ones who are committing great evil in the world, we cannot do that. We have to rely on the Holy Spirit. Let the Spirit guide us, not our flesh, not our mind's understanding or our hearts, because our hearts are evil. We need to be renewed. Renewed with the Holy Spirit. And you can only get the Holy Spirit once you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Follow him. He's your king. Listen and follow him. Sounds easy, but it's not sometimes. But I still wouldn't say it's hard, right? The only thing that gets in the way really is our own souls. It's our own desires that we can't let go. So the Lord's going to work with us on that. That's a promise. So we're going to be getting better as we go along here. But don't fall asleep. Don't think, no matter what happens, you're fine. And God will never let anything happen to you. That's just not true. Things physically will happen to you. And the Great Tribulation, if you're alive for it, the Antichrist and the beast system gets to beat us physically. We are trodden down and conquered and all that stuff. We're still the saints, but if you're enduring, if you give your life for the Lord, that's the greatest destiny you can have. If you survive to the end, great, then you'll be raptured. That's at the return. We talked about this week or two ago. Pretty simple. There's no pre-tribulation rapture. It's a lie. It's from hell. So don't believe it. And I'm sure you're probably in a church that believes it and maybe even teaches it. And I'm sorry for that, but that's the truth. If you're not, if you're in a Catholic or Orthodox church, you don't talk about that subject at all because they're amillennial. They dismiss all the prophecies about the Lord's return and the thousand-year reign, except for, yeah, he's coming back one day. We don't know what it is. There'll be no signs around it. It's imminent. Could be any time. Maybe there's an Antichrist. Maybe there's not. And when he comes, he judges the whole world, and that's it. So it's a very different teaching. You have to come out of these lies and recognize the original belief of the church, the original apostles. The original teachings of the first century and second century were exactly what me and other ministries like this are talking about. It's post-tribulationism. It's a thousand-year literal reign of Jesus Christ. There's an actual Antichrist. There's a false prophet. There's a false religious system. All that stuff, Mark of the Beast, all that everyone else avoids or says we're going to avoid, we go through. That's the point, honestly. The Great Tribulation serves two purposes. One, to set the dividing line out, right? And to punish the ones who would follow the beast, but also to cleanse and purify the church, to see who is really who, right? At the end, we're going to have a special contest? I don't know what to call it, really. But if you're alive in that last generation, the Lord will offer you the most unprecedented, really, rewards, which is to resist the most horrific persecution in the history of earth. That's the words of Jesus, not me. So if you endure through it, whether you're killed on the way or you survive through it till he returns, your rewards will be great indeed. So, yes, it's negative in a way, but the positives will far, far outweigh that. All right, so that's where we're at. Again, this is Christopher Manti, host of Frontline. I appreciate your input, one and all. And I love you, and hopefully we can do some good things here today. First and foremost, let's go over these headlines that you may not know. There is a jihad alert out right now, specifically in Minnesota, the Mall of America. It's obviously a huge mall, biggest in the country, biggest in probably in the Western Hemisphere. And it's obviously highly symbolic and a soft target, as you would say in terrorism land. The people in there are not defending themselves and I don't think they're allowed to, actually. I'm sure it's a no-gun zone. So there's been a specific threat against the Mall of America, against Canadian malls as well, and London malls in the United Kingdom. So be alert. Those are specific locations. The threat comes from Al-Shabaab, which is in Somalia. Most people are like, what in the hey? Who cares? Why is Somalia after us? You know, one day you're going to wake up and learn that it's not Somalia, Al-Shabaab, Al-Qaeda, Islamic State, etc., whatever. It's all religion. We are a great enemy of Islam, whether we want to be or not. And they have to take us down, and they will. They're going to try, no matter where they're from. That's the call of Muhammad. That's what they do. The moderate Muslims that you may know in your town or your work or school, what have you, most of them are very nice people. I get it. But they're not doing Islam correctly. They're lying when they say these terrorist groups are misrepresenting Islam. That is absolutely backwards. You, the moderate Muslim, are misrepresenting Islam, and I thank you for that. Please continue to do so. We don't want the true Islam. It's the beast. So please stop. You know, or continue to not do it right. We appreciate you. And obviously, any Muslim that you come across, you want to preach the gospel to them. That is your duty. And I know in my neck of the woods, almost every Muslim around here is an ex-Christian. Grew up in Christian homes. I'm sure were evangelized to Islam through the prison system and just walking the streets. You know, good old-fashioned evangelization. So it's not as in some other places like Michigan or like Minnesota or like Europe, a lot of places in Europe. It's not an immigration thing. You guys, I know there are people, especially, you know, I have Facebook friends and et cetera, who all day long will say, stop the immigration, and then tie that to terrorists, to Muslims. I'm sorry, but that's not what they all are. Many Muslims are Americans, never have been in another country, have not emigrated here. They're born and raised and as American as you. You have to get that through your mind. Please stop this immigration kick. It's not about that. And of course there are, you know, big demonstrations that the media will not tell you about in Germany, especially in Europe, by anti-Islamic protesters, but unfortunately a lot of that is anti-immigrant protests also, and that's not the truth. The truth is resisting Islam, resisting the beast, which is what Resist the Beast is all about. Please go there, resistthebeast.org, or .net to buy your shirt or bumper sticker or mug, whatever, sweatshirt, to show the public. It's not for your house to keep in your closet or in your cabinet. It's to show the public where you stand, and you have had enough. That is good. Stand up for the Lord Jesus. Most of the shirts say right on it, and I have one. It says, I wore it out this weekend. But in public and to a worship meeting. A house of prayer meeting. It says, Jesus Christ is my Lord. I will not submit to Islam. That's the truth. That's what we want to get at. And it's all good to go to war with ISIS, but the fact is you have to evangelize them. That's our duty. Anyway, before I get off track here, okay, why? So Minnesota has a large Somalian population, so that's why Al-Shabaab from Somalia has a threat out against the Mall of America, because they have agents there, okay? And again, we have specific alert about that. And Canada, I guess in the major cities, you know, you don't have much of a mall in the middle of the wilderness up there. But Toronto and Ottawa, I'm sure, and Montreal, watch out. And then London, okay? And there is a blurb from South Africa also. There are apparently terrorist agents that are like 10 or 12 of them that are active in South Africa right now. So just be vigilant, as we say. Keep your eyes open. Carry your weapon if you have one. If you don't have one, get one. Just be smart and teach your family about it and have them prepared, okay? And on a more militaristic scale, we have a threat to Italy, to Rome, but really to all Italy from ISIS in Libya. Everyone calls them ISIS except for Obama, and then it's ISIL. Just call it Islamic State, IS, okay? Because frankly, it's beyond Iraq and Syria, which is what IS means, or even the Levant, ISIL. The Levant doesn't cover Libya or Egypt or Tunisia, but they're there also. So Islamic State, it's the Caliphate. That's not a big deal to every Muslim on earth knows what the Caliphate is. It's the way Islam is supposed to be practiced. Anyways, we'll talk about that more in a minute. But Italy is actually under threat because there are jets, you know, military airplanes that are under control of the Islamists in Libya. I don't know strictly if they're ISIS or if they're some other name, but it doesn't really matter. They actually have airplanes, and they're loading up these boats with, quote, immigrants, and are sailing over to Italy in record numbers here the past couple weeks. So they're very afraid. And they should be. Or, you know, I mean, fear is not a thing for Christians, but you should be. It should be taken seriously, all right? I think they are, but what's the thing I said? Their military budget is so small that they only have 5,000 or 500? Some ridiculously small number of troops that are active or ready to fight. Good luck with that. Islamic State has 50,000, and they're not even a real state, according to the world. And so they're under threat right now, and they would, trust me, for all you people who may be under the illusion that Islam is either partnering with or was created by the Vatican, I feel so bad for you. You're so wrong. I mean, so very, very wrong. And don't tell me, don't send me evidence. This is bogus. I know, I've seen the evidence. It's just like 9/11 truthers. You can show me your evidence that the buildings didn't fall down from airplanes. for 1,000 years and you're still nuts, okay? You're still wrong and crazy. So the Islam would like nothing more. They are not partnering with the Vatican. They were not created by Catholics. They want to kill the Pope. They want to destroy Vatican City and claim it for Islam and fly that black flag over the Vatican. That is their one of their great dreams. Other than Jerusalem, that's, I would say that's the number two on the list. Because Rome to them, and to most of our world, represents Christianity. Whether, no matter what you think of the Roman Catholic Church today, but since the inception of Islam 1,400 years ago, remember, 1,400 years ago, there was only one church, one Christian church. They hadn't even divided into Orthodox and Catholic, East and West, you know, Orthodox and Catholic yet. There was just one. I mean, there were disagreements within it, okay, but that was the Church of Jesus Christ. And Muhammad knew that and targeted it. Eventually, he knew he wanted to go there. He had to take care of some other things closer to home first, so come up through Arabia, and get the Middle East taken care of first, and then go to Rome. So Rome has always, 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 always been Christianity to the Muslims. Second, today, you know, you see practically America is, because we're the superpower and we're a Christian nation. That's, it was founded by Christians and that's it. I know today we're not doing a good job of it. We're doing a terrible job. But to them, we are the target. Us and Rome are the most symbolic of all. That's why they went bombed the Twin Towers and the Pentagon, because of the symbology of it. Anyway, so Rome is under threat. And just please don't listen to anyone, any voice in your head or any other human that says that Islam is trying to merge or help the Vatican or getting help from the Vatican. That's bull. It's crap. Don't believe it. It doesn't mean anything about Catholicism other than it's false to say they are working with Islam in any way. There is no drive by Muslims to unite with Christianity. That is world-class stupid. It doesn't get any more dumb than that. They will never unite with any other religion, and it will never be wiped out again, contrary to some crazy prophecy teachers who think sometime before Jesus returns, Islam will be destroyed. Just all of them. It'll be, no one will be a Muslim anymore. I mean, this is just insane. So that's our enemy in the flesh, and we don't battle against flesh and blood. I understand that, but that's it. There's no reason to look any farther. There's no reason to draw false connections. There's no reason to put on your brother's account charge of your enemy. The Catholic Church is not our enemy. I'm not a Catholic. I was born and raised. I left the church when I was a teenager many years ago. I'm never going back, but the point is, they're your brother, okay? And so were the Orthodox. So were the Coptics. So are every Protestant denomination. So is every Messianic denomination. Okay? Clear? Because the Muslims look at us all the same. If we wear the cross, we should be dead. Okay, so there's your specific threat from Italy, United States, Canada, London. And I'll take a quick break here and show you the Wings of the Eagle, my latest video on it. There is a new one in the works that I'm very, very, very excited about. And it's longer and more dramatic even than this one. So, but it's still being worked on. So pray for me for that. And I want the right medium to premiere it in. And here it is. Wings of the Eagle, please pay attention and know that it is here for you. For us to speak to each other so the Lord may hear us. and write us in his book of remembrance. Yes, my friends, wingsoftheeagle.com. This is Frontline. I'm Christopher Mantype. Please go to wingsoftheeagle.com right now. It's a free network. Free. Never will cost you anything. Go there, put your information, submit it. There's a form on the tab called Organize. Put in your information, whatever you want to be public. Put it out there. Find your brothers and sisters. Let them find you. And let's go. Let's make a plan here. Let's, whatever the Lord is leading you to do, let's start it. Does the abomination of desolation has to happen first before you get serious? Does the final agreement, the last 7 years, and Israel gets a peace treaty and the temple is rebuilt? Do you need that to get serious? Come on, guys, let's go. Same thing with resist the beast. We have had good sales here this week, a lot better than it had been, but I'm telling you, that we have a lot more visitors than we do sales, a lot more. I got curious, so I'm going to look right now, and, I don't want to give away the, state secrets here as far as actual numbers, but I know it's a lot of views. People are looking at the products, but most of them are not buying. Why? We never had any legitimate complaints about the design. Nobody said, oh, this looks terrible. All right, here we go. Okay. Well, let's just say we've had visitors a lot. A lot. And orders of a few, not a lot. All right, is that clear as mud? We have to do more. I mean, what is it, other than fear? What is the problem? It's not too expensive. I mean, I'm sure. $5 for a shirt would be great, but that's not possible. We can't do it. It can't be done. No one will make them. It's $20 for a two-sided t-shirt. It means you have full-color graphics, full-color t-shirt, and full-color graphics on the front and the back. $20. If you want only one side, just the front, $15. What's wrong with that? You go to a concert, and you pay $40 for a stinking t-shirt. Sweatshirt. I think that's even that's less than 40, 30 something. And the bumper stickers, like, what is it? I'll say like $6 or $7. So come on. I mean, there's no excuse at all, honestly. I bet you spend more on your lunch with you and your spouse or whatever. For in other words, let's get serious, okay? Come on. I mean, don't buy if you don't want to. I'm not saying, you know, don't force anybody to do it. But if you're feeling it, and I know people agree because we post things, I do, or Armageddon News, who I'm partnering with, Wings of the Eagle and Armageddon News together. We've got resistthebeast.net or .org. Go there, see what we have to offer. We're partnering with it. And I'm telling you, we put on, you know, something goes up, say, hey, check out this shirt or check out the website. We get hundreds of likes. We have thousands and thousands and thousands of people viewing a design. Thousands. Nobody buys them. Not nobody, but comparatively speaking. What is that about? Shoot me a note, please. Email me or chat with me or Twitter, tweet me. Tell me the answer. Well, if there's something that we're missing, we'll change it. We'll tweak it. But the price is what it is. The design, I think, is great. It's excellent, but we're tweaking that today. Some of them will be a little bit different. But what's wrong? You're afraid that someone's going to hurt you, right? That's the bottom line. You're afraid a Muslim is going to come kill you because you have a shirt on that says resist the beast, right? What else is it? If it's not that, what is it? I don't understand. This is time is too serious and too short, A, to be afraid of anything, but to witness for the Lord, that's the greatest calling there is. There's no greater destiny. There's no greater job you can have. There's all the money in the world is nothing, means nothing for you to witness for him. Compared to it, this means nothing at all. Your career, your house, your friends that you're proud of hosting, whatever. Whatever your thing is, whatever you're hung up on, instead of the Lord, I don't get it. Anyway, so if you're feeling it, just do it. I want to encourage you. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Unite. This is how we're going to unite the church. One of the ways. Obviously, it's up to God. I'm not doing anything. But this is an easy way to do it. An easy way. The hashtag, right? You see on my video, you saw it. And on these t-shirts, you'll see it. It's the number sign, hashtag, resist the beast. Put that on your social media. Put that on your Twitter and your Facebook, your emails. That's an easy way to unite us. All over the world. Every nation can do that. Every Christian in every nation. Well, those with access to a smartphone, at least. We'd be surprised how many there are. So please just don't be afraid, okay? And Wings of the Eagle is there for you to prepare us and to facilitate meetings so you can find your fellow believers who know what's coming, who know that we'll be here through the tribulation, who know maybe they don't know about Islam or they don't want to believe it yet, but they know something. They know we're in the last days. I was talking to a brother of mine yesterday, and he said the church he's in, everyone knows. They, to a man, they will say we are in the last days. The last generation. That you could feel it in the air. You can see it happening on in the earth. But almost every one of them is a pre-tribulation believer, so there's some work to do in that. But the fact is, they can feel it, and you can feel it. Be a leader. If no one is stepping up, you step up. God doesn't, what is it, the saying? God doesn't call the qualified, he qualifies the called. You don't have to go to Bible college to teach the Word of God. You don't have to have some special degree or job of importance or be an elected official. That's all lies of the devil and of the world. You don't need any of that. If you do, that's great. But if you don't, that's great too. Who was John the Baptist? Who was Peter the fisherman? Who was Matthew the tax collector? Who was Luke the physician? Who was Mark the kid? These are their kids. Who was Stephen? Who was Shaul? Who was Paul? Who was a terrorist? He killed Christians. And yet, God used him pretty good, didn't he? The disciples were a bunch of nobodies, my friends. Who was Moses? To God, right? I mean, so he had a job in Egypt. He quit that job. He had to go into the wilderness and be alone and lose everything. Then God raised him up. Who was Gideon? Who were these guys? They were nobodies. So don't be discouraged. God just wants your willingness. He'll give you the words. He'll give you the courage. He'll give you the open door. He'll open the door for you. Sometimes he'll push you through the door. If you've gone up to a certain point and you're faithful in step A and B, he's going to ram you into step X. Sometimes. I know it's happened. All of a sudden, you don't know, you're in a daze. How did all this come about? How did I get here? How did I get trust like this? How did I get respect like this? How did I get favor? Oh, God can do that and more. So don't give up. And don't let the devil lie to you and say you're not worthy of it or something. God justifies. Who is he who can lay the charge to God's elect? Who are the elect? Christians who stay true to the end. So take courage. If you're feeling like you should witness to the world through one of these Resist the Beast t-shirts or bumper stickers, just buy it. Buy 10, I don't care. You know, give it to friends for free then. Show you're willing. So anyway, go to wingsoftheeagle.com, go to Armageddon News on Facebook and YouTube, and you will learn a lot. And it doesn't mean you have to agree with every single thing and every video that you might see or every story that you might see posted on the Facebook page, but there's no group that has a better grasp and are telling you the things that matter more than them. I don't know of them. So join us and let's rock. Okay? All right, what I want to do now is I guess we'll do Psalm 74 in a few minutes. The one other aspect of the news that you may not have seen is the government of Turkey. Short version is there is a long-standing... There's a tomb in northern Syria, but it belongs to Turkey. It's their property. I know it's weird. They have an old treaty where even though it's not in Turkish land, it's treated as... It's kind of like an embassy where it's really technically the property of another nation. Anyway, it's a little park with a tomb in it. It's the founder of the Ottoman Empire. Okay, so they love that whole empire thing. And there's a tomb there, and it's always been Turkish, and now ISIS is threatening it, even though Turkey created ISIS and finances it, but that's neither here nor there. They put on a big dog and pony show yesterday or day before yesterday, where they went in, Turkey did, with dozens of military vehicles, attack helicopters, tanks, drones, an AWACS, eye in the air for communications. I mean, they did it full on to go to this tomb, and they say to get the remains of this man that's there, this founder, and move it to somewhere else in Syria. That's bogus. You know why? Because there is no body in there. There never was. Never was. There's nothing to move. They might be hiding some kind of chemical weapons or some kind of holy relics that they don't want to tell the world about. I don't know. But it's not a body. Because the records of that time say this guy, Suleiman Shah, is his name. He died near the Euphrates River, which is very far away, and his body was never recovered. So they made a shrine to him in lieu of the body, but there is no body there. Anyway, be that as it may, some people like Walid Shobat are very excited about this because they see it as a beginning of a Turkish takeover. They'll defeat ISIS and then they'll claim the caliphate. Well, I would just say, hold on a minute there. You're jumping the gun because, as I read Daniel, and as several other ministries are coming to realize, Iran and the Persian Empire of old will be the ones taking care of ISIS. Thank you very much. And they will claim the caliphate. They might even have a Mahdi, the Imam Mahdi, the 12th Imam, whatever the Shiite version of it is. They might even have him to be their leader through this campaign. And they're looking at Syria as the flashpoint for that Mahdi. Just as ISIS is, by the way. They want the West to come with ground troops so they can their prophecies can be fulfilled. And this will. You think ISIS and people are bad now? Wait till that happens. And as you can see, okay, so before I forget, Iran is will have the caliphate next. Then Daniel teaches, then Turkey will counterattack Iran and consolidate power of the entire Middle East under Turkish rule. Whether they call it a caliphate at that point or not, I don't know, but it will be a de facto Turkish caliphate. The Ottoman Empire will be reborn. Then Daniel teaches us they will divide it into four pieces, the whole region, north, south, east, and west. Maybe they'll just call it north, south, east, and west Ottomanville. I don't know. Maybe they'll say New Iran, New Iraq. I don't know. Out of one of those, the north part of it comes what we call the Antichrist. Then the 10 kings will all be united, and we have a deal for the temple in Israel. Now we are going nonstop, can't be turned back. We are in the final 7 years. Let's go, 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 go. It's on. There's a process. Okay, so I disagree with people who say the Turkish takeover is imminent. It is not. Iran's all over the news, but 99% of the Iranian stories are against Israel. They're not coming against Israel. There's no prophecies about that. The only one that there is involves Persia in union with Turkey and Jordan and Egypt, Libya, right? It's called Gog and Magog. At the end, yes, they're all united, and then they invade Israel. The final 3.5 years, that's the time frame. Not before that. So I don't think Iran gets off a shot, a meaningful shot on Israel ever by themselves. So I think it's just a big ruse. Now, Israel believes it, okay? Netanyahu, most respected leader on earth, I think, to me. Canada's got a good one, and Australia's got a good one. It's a short list. So Netanyahu really believes that Iran will try to eradicate them, and I get it. But we as Christians are supposed to know the real deal, because we have the New Testament to enlighten us. So anyway, I see Iran attacking Saudi Arabia. Yes, I see them attacking Turkey and Iraq and Syria. That's what I see. That's what I see Daniel telling me, us. So that is what you're looking for next, then Turkey. Okay, so these moves that Turkey's making in Syria, it's interesting. I wouldn't say it's a sign of anything specifically yet. Okay, Psalm 74 we'll get to in a bit. And right now I want to show you this 10-minute video called The Coming Caliphate, Arab Spring. Now again, just to set this up, we all know what the Arab Spring is or was. This video was created 4 years ago, when all this was just getting going. Some of it didn't happen yet at all. The Syrian civil war hadn't even begun. So pay attention. And the reason why this is so prescient, prophetic, is because this gentleman, brother who made this, knows the scriptures. God knows what's coming. All right? So pay attention. If you have any questions, let me know. But here it is. Arab Spring, the coming caliphate, here on Frontline. Are you ready for Jesus indeed? Are You Ready for Jesus actually is the name of a book that is coming out in 3 months, somewhere in May. I know the author personally, and this is a great move of the Holy Spirit. Are You Ready for Jesus will be a directed at pastors specifically, not your normal folks, your church goers, but your actual leaders of the churches, to wake them up, to let you know that being ready for Jesus is an active, participatory thing. It's not ho-humming and Jesus could come back at any time. That's a lie. And this book will show that it's a lie, and hopefully we'll wake up pastors to that so they can protect their flock. That their job, is it not, of a shepherd? To protect them at all costs, to die for them if need be. And that's what we're coming to. So they better be ready. And you better be ready. So you saw it there in the video. He says, this is a 4-year-old video, and it says the Caliphate is coming. And the Bible says it's coming. Well, guess what? The video was just 3 years off, because in 2014, the Khalifa returned. The Caliphate returned in the land of the Babylonians, in Iraq and Syria. That's the land of ancient Babylon, folks. That's where King Nebuchadnezzar reigned. And that's where ISIS came from. What a coincidence. Not. That's why I keep pointing people to the book of Daniel, chapter 7, 8, and 11. 7 lays out if the beast of Revelation 13 is the Caliphate, as you just saw in that video, it's a cut and dry case to me. If that's the wounded head that revives and resurrects in the last days, the only empire around who's still around. there's no movement to resurrect the Roman Empire or the Greek Empire or the Egyptian Empire, etc. Okay, but the Caliphate is back as of last year. Daniel 7 says the first beast to arise is the lion. In the book of Daniel, there are four kingdoms mentioned over and over and over and over. They're not different. They're all the same. Chapter 2, then chapter 7. I'll even chapter 5, then chapter 7, then chapter 8, then chapter 11. Babylon, then Persia, then Yvan, then the Ten Horn Kingdom. Some of it is historical in reference, especially chapter 2, but Daniel 7 is not historical. Daniel 8 is not historical. Chapter 11 is not historical. In the same land of Babylon, the Caliphate would be reborn. That's what Daniel 7 teaches us. Then it's the bear of Persia who takes it. Then it's the four-headed leopard of Yvan, or what you would call Greece. That's how it's translated as Greece, but it's Yvan. That's the western coast of Turkey. That's where the capital is. And then comes the ten-horn beast of the end. So you think it's a coincidence that the same lion, bear, and leopard are used to describe the final beast in Revelation? You think that's just by chance? You don't think that's what's telling you the lands to look at, where they will be, where this kingdom is? Get your eyes off Europe, Russia, America, anywhere else you might be looking. You saw in that video, just overlap where the Persian, Greek, and Babylonian empires of history are, and you'll see the Middle East. So Babylon first, that's ISIS. Persia next, that's Iran. They're coming. It might be this year. Might be very soon. They're going to invade Iraq and Syria. I think also Saudi Arabia and Turkey. Then it's Turkey's turn. Okay, so do you get it? Do you see it's actually real? It's coming true. We have to know where to look. And again, this is why the spread agreement throughout the scriptures, not just Daniel, not just Revelation, it agrees with Revelation and also agrees with Ezekiel, like that video was pointing out. It agrees with the Psalms, like that video pointed out. The prophets of God all say the same thing. Otherwise, they're not from God. Just like today, if some prophet claims that there's a pre-trib rapture, he's not speaking for God. If he claims the beast kingdom is European, he's not speaking for God. Because that's not what the Bible says at all. All right, speaking of the Psalms, I said I was going to give you some teachings from the Psalms. So let's go. First of all, I will hit Psalm 74 here. But... the Arab Spring and these uprisings and the dictators that the West was supporting, but now we're not. There's a reason for all this. It's called Psalm 2. Why do the nations or the heathen, the good old King James is heathen. Why do the heathen nations rage? Days of rage, that's an actual expression the Muslims use when they overthrow their governments. Days of rage. Why do they rage? Nation, a heathen. Who's a heathen in the Middle East? And the people plot a vain thing. What's the vain thing? Here we go. The kings of the earth, Middle East, set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord, Yehovah, the true God, not Allah, but the true God of the Bible, and against his anointed, capital A, his Messiah. That's the word Mashiach, anointed. Okay? That's Jesus Christ, who take counsel together against God the Father and his Messiah, Jesus. Do you know anybody who's against the Father and the Son? Saying, let us break their bonds in pieces and cast away their cords from us. Let us be unfettered from this Christianity and these Jews. He who sits in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall hold them in derision. This is from New King James, by the way. Just want to give you that heads up. And he shall speak to them in his wrath and distress them in his deep displeasure. He takes care of these nations when he comes in wrath. The wrath of God is at the end of the tribulation. Got it? So we have to endure the tribulation before God takes care of business for us. Then he shall speak to them, in his wrath, and yet... this is God talking. Yet I have set my king, who's the king? King Jesus, on my holy hill of Zion. Jerusalem, Mount of Olives, Mount Zion, the temple. Temple Mount, okay? That's where Jesus will rule from as king for 1,000 years. This is in the Psalms. And I will declare the decree. The Lord has said to me, wait a minute here. The Lord has said to me, who is talking? It's not David. The Lord says, I will declare the decree. The Lord, Yehovah, says to me, capital M, who's that? The anointed, the Messiah. This is the Father speaking to Jesus, all right? The Lord has said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Huh. It's a lot like the voice that John the Baptist heard and some others when Jesus was baptized. You are my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. The Lord says to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Now remember that because it's important here. Ask of me and I will give you the nations for your inheritance and the ends of the earth for your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron and you shall dash them to pieces like the potter's vessel. Who rules with a rod of iron? John in Revelation tells us two or three times that Jesus rules with the rod of iron. This is the messianic age. It's the 1,000 years, literal, on earth from Jerusalem. Jesus does not return to Rome. He does not figuratively rule for 1,000 years. This is a literal thing. It's going to happen. Shall break them with a rod of iron. Now, therefore, be wise, O kings. Wise up, you kings of the Middle East. Be instructed, you judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear. That's the true God. With fear. And rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry. And you perish in the way. You understand that? If you don't give love to Jesus, it's over for you. When his wrath is kindled but a little, you will perish. He only needs to be a little angry, and you're out of here. Blessed are all those who put their trust in him. Praise God. Christians who put their trust in him, in Jesus. So this is a messianic psalm. Prophecy. This is a big, big deal. Now, remember I said it's important that it says, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. And he's talking to the kings of the Middle East. Why is it important that he says, you are my son. Today I have begotten you? Let's go to Psalm 74. I'm going to go back to the NASB for this one. Spell it right, I'll get there. Okay. Let's see Islam in the Bible. Are you ready? A Maskil of Asaph, Psalm 74. O God, why have you rejected us forever? These are the current occupants of Jerusalem speaking. Why does your anger smoke against the sheep of your pasture? Because they reject him. Remember your congregation, which you have purchased of old, which you have redeemed to be the tribe of your inheritance. Tribes of Israel, tribe of Judah. And this Mount Zion, where you have dwelt. Uh-oh, here we go again. This is Mount Zion, the king of Judah, the king of the Jews, Jesus Christ, the Lion of Judah, will reign from Mount Zion, just where he had dwelt before, where God spoke to the Israelites, to David, to King David and Solomon, etc. Turn your footsteps towards the perpetual ruins. The enemy has damaged everything within the sanctuary. Now listen. Who is the enemy who's damaged the sanctuary where the temple is? Or was and will be. Your adversaries have roared in the midst of your meeting place. Mount Zion. They have set up their own standards for signs. I wish I had a picture that I could. I can actually, but I don't have it handy. I don't have it handy. But there is a building on the Temple Mount, on Mount Zion, in Jerusalem, right now, with banners, standards and signs, literal signs, banners, things on the wall, proclaiming their victory over that space. It's in Arabic. It proclaims there's no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. That's what it says. It doesn't say the true God of Israel and his son. No, no, no. Let's continue. And it seems as if one had lifted up his axe from a forest of trees, in a forest of trees, and now all its carved work they smash with hatchets and hammers. That's exactly what Muslims do. Look at what ISIS is doing to tombs in Nineveh. Any church that won't, they can't make a new mosque, they destroy it. They break the crosses, literally. They have burned your sanctuary to the ground. By the way, they have defiled your dwelling place of your name. All right, let's do the next one. They said in their heart, now perk up. They said in their heart, let us completely subdue them. Let us completely subdue them. The ESV says, English Standard Version says, we will utterly subdue them. What's the point of that? Poignancy of that word? Subdue? To submit? Islam means submission! That's what it literally means. To submit or subdue. The Quran tells the Muslims to subdue your enemies. Make them feel subdued. And that's exactly what they did in Jerusalem. Oh, by the way, isn't it talking about a destruction of the temple? They have burned all the meeting places of God in the land. They have defiled your dwelling place of your name, the dwelling place of your name, your sanctuary burned to the ground. Did you know in 70 AD the temple of God was burned to the ground by Arabs and Syrians? People say, oh, no, that's the Romans did that. They were in the Roman army. They were drafted into the army. But the Syrians and Arabs are the ones who destroyed the temple against the wishes, by the way, of the Roman general. He didn't want the temple burned down, but they would not be stopped. They had to burn that thing down. That's history. Josephus and other historians prove it. This is why Daniel would say the people of the prince to come will destroy the city and sanctuary. The Islamic people did it. There was no such thing as Islam then, but Satan certainly had them, and their descendants, they did it in 70 AD, and then their descendants did it in year 690-ish, when they created what's called the Dome of the Rock, an Al-Aqsa Mosque, on the site of the temple. And hanging in that site are banners, flags, sayings written right on the walls. Remember before in Psalm 2, it said to pick up on the verse, you are my son, today I have begotten you. Why is that a big deal? Because in the Dome of the Rock today, the Muslim mosque says, God has no son. Don't say we have begotten one. Allah has begotten no one. It's a direct contradiction of the Bible, of Psalm 2, and of course the New Testament. John would tell us in his epistles that that is the Antichrist who you're looking for. The spirit of Antichrist will say there is no God but Allah, not Yahuwah, and he has no son, and he has not begotten. Anyone who says that should be decapitated. That's the truth. And why do the saints in the tribulation, why they be beheaded? Why are they beheaded? Now you know. You know who does it now, right? God has no son. It's literally written on the place where Jesus will sit and rule from his throne. They are trying to preempt his return. Satan is trying to say, and will say, we'll say it many times before the end, especially in the abomination of desolation. He will sit on that spot where Jesus is coming back and say, you can't have this. It's mine. I rule the world. And Islam is his way, his means to his end. He is their God. All right, let's finish Psalm 74 here. They said in their heart, let us completely subdue them. Let us Islam them. They have burned all the meeting places of God in the land. We do not see our signs. There is no longer any prophet, nor there is any among us who knows how long. How long, O God, will the adversary revile and the enemy spurn your name forever? What are the martyrs under the altar saying to Jesus before the tribulation begins? How long, O Lord? How long, O God, will the adversary revile us, the enemy, Satan? We know in Revelation, Satan is cast to the earth for the last 3.5 years, and that's when the Great Tribulation begins, and that's when the church is persecuted everywhere. Why do you withdraw your hand, even your right hand? Who's the right hand? That's the Messiah. Who sits at the right hand of God? The Messiah, Jesus. The Jews are saying, why do you withdraw the Messiah? Because they reject him. They don't know. They don't know him. From within your bosom, destroy them, the cry will come. Yet God is my king from of old, who works deeds of deliverance in the midst of the earth. You divided the sea by your strength. You broke the heads of the sea monsters in the waters. Wait a minute. Sea monsters, that's a beast in the water. Sure, there's no purpose in saying that. You have crushed the heads of Leviathan. Leviathan, the sea monster. With many heads. Huh. Where have I read that before? Seven-headed beast from the waters, the sea, the great sea. I'll leave that to you guys. And they're all connected, right? Leviathan, sea monster, many heads. You gave him as food to the creatures of the wilderness. Creatures of the wilderness. That's a reference also to a certain plot of land in the Middle East. You broke open springs and torrents. You dried up ever-flowing streams. Yours is the day. Yours also is the night. You have prepared the light and the sun. You have established all the boundaries of the earth. You have made summer and winter. Remember this, O Lord, that the enemy has reviled and a foolish people has spurned your name. I don't care if you're a Jew or a Christian right now. Don't spurn his name, because you're a fool if you do. You will not be protected. Do not deliver the soul of your turtle dove to the wild beast. Do not forget the life of your afflicted forever. He won't, but you have to cry to him. Come to the Messiah. Consider the covenant the new covenant. Consider the covenant. Sorry, I wanted to make sure I was still broadcasting. I had a little hiccup here on my monitor. Consider the covenant, Psalm 74:20. Consider the covenant. For the dark places of the land are full of the inhabitations of violence. Huh. Any, that ring a bell at all? Let not the oppressed return dishonored. Let the afflicted and needy praise your name. Yes, we need to do that, my friends. Arise, O God. Arise, O God, and plead your own cause. Remember how the foolish man reproaches you all day long. Do not forget the voice of your adversaries, the uproar of those who rise against you, which ascends continually. And this ties right back into Psalm 2. The uproar, the nations, the heathen raging and uproaring against you and your anointed, your Messiah. Okay, there's Islam. Right there, plain and simple, they're actual the name of the religion, what they did in history, what they are doing today, and what they will do in the future. All over that chapter. Those two chapters, really. All right, I hope you could see that clearly. Psalm 74. Take a quick break, please. This is something you need to pay attention to, because we are his eyewitnesses.
There is a sense in the world. There's a sense among believers. There's a sense among unbelievers. There's a sense among all peoples that things are unhinged. The Middle East is unhinged with uprisings, revolutions, and where is this heading?
How are followers of Jesus to relate to all of these things? How do they relate to biblical prophecy?
America is in spiritual, moral crisis. Values are changing, and so rapidly. I mean, that have not happened in the history of man.
How are level-headed, responsible Christians to relate to the testimony of the biblical prophets and the unfolding of chaos throughout the world?
Not just believers are wondering, is this a sign of the end?
Yes, my friends, welcome back to Frontline. If these are the times of the end, then we are end times eyewitnesses for the Lord Jesus. How do we go about that? What are we expecting to see? Please buy that DVD right now. It's by Joel Richardson. You just saw it. It's called End Times Eyewitness. Go to joelstrumpet.com. That's his site, and order it directly there, or go to Amazon or WorldNet Daily, anywhere you want. Just get it, and get it in front of your church. Get it in front of your small group. Get it in front of your community center, your Jewish community center. Anywhere you can think of. Get creative. Pass it around. That's what I'm doing. It's been making the rounds here in my circle of influence for about 2 months. And almost 3 months now. And it just has to be seen, because the church is dead asleep. We are snoozing. We don't, like I was saying before, even if you know that we're in the last generation, you know the Lord's coming soon, but you don't know what to expect next. That's bonkers. How could you not know? Jesus said, I told you beforehand. What's the matter with you? Have you not read? Have you not read? Have you not read? Have you not read? It's all there in black and white. Everything important. Not every detail of every day, but everything you need to know. So what is the next event? What is the what are the signs? Can you enumerate them? Can you go to your, can your pastor or your priest, can your church, your fellow believers, can you enumerate what the signs of the times are? What has already happened? What is happening today? What's happening next? What's to come? Don't you know those answers? Why don't you know those answers? Can't tell me right now. Challenge yourself. There's, guys, in this day where we live, there's no better form of evangelism than prophecy. Just like in the original church, the reason why the church exploded in numbers from nothing to thousands and thousands and thousands and flipped the whole Middle East upside down and then flipped the Roman Empire upside down and everything else and created Europe is because they had the power of fulfilled prophecy. There were thousands of years of these prophecies coming. And people are wondering, oh, what's that about? Jesus! He came, he fulfilled 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And he's coming back and he's going to fulfill all the rest of them that aren't yet. This is the guy. This is the one to demonstrate. These are the things you use to show, yes, Christianity is true. Jesus is the truth. You need to be his disciple. You don't want to go to hell, because that's the choice. Certainly don't follow Satan and his various religions, but the most, the one that Satan is using and God will allow is called Islam. You have to say that. You have to show that Islam is rising. The Caliphate is the beast. Refuse to resist it, you know, that refuse to conform, to submit, refuse to submit, and to resist it. Pull people out of the fire. Say, look, prophecy's happening. Daniel says this is what happened exactly in the place where it is happening. When Iran invades, you can say, I told you so. The Bible told you so. This is a great tool, the greatest tool. Jesus is coming back. You just saw step A. There's B, C, and D to come. Let's go. Get on the bus. Get into the wedding, right? Send out the invitations now. Don't keep it to yourself. Time for sleep, laziness, and self-sufficiency are over. Get out there. Do a radio broadcast. Get on the internet like crazy. Evangelize. Tell the truth. Spread the true gospel. And I don't know if you noticed the real quick segment of that video I just showed for End Times Eyewitness is a whole bunch of Egyptians in a church that's literally cut out of a mountain. That's where we are resorted to gather in the Islamic country of Egypt. And thousands of people are there all night long. And I want to show you that clip that you saw real quick. They were saying, Yeshua! In unison. It's Jesus. His real name, Yeshua. Look how happy. I have a video of that event. 10 minutes long. Can you imagine? Have you seen anything like this in your church? No, you have not. I guarantee you haven't. Because it doesn't happen here. Because we don't know the pressure of persecution. We don't know the truth, the true meaning of a disciple, being a disciple of Jesus. This will show you. Remember, too, that when you see this, these are right after several Christians were murdered brutally, drowned in the Nile River for being Christians, not unlike what just happened with these beheadings by ISIS. They are under threat in their own country. They have to meet like this in a mountain just to proclaim the name of Jesus. They love him more than we do. I'm sorry. But if that offends you, maybe you need to be offended a little bit, because they are in the middle of dying for their faith, and look how they react. Watch this.
Thank you.
Do you get the point? That was not edited. In fact, that was cut off. Over 10 minutes. Nothing but shouting the name above all names. The only name by which we can be saved. Yeshua. Over and over and over. These are brothers and sisters who've lost family members and friends to Satan and his religion. Jesus told us that one day we would be killed by those who think they were doing God a service. So it is. Pray for your sisters and brothers, your church, everywhere in the world, especially those under persecution, under Islamic rule. Know that the Holy Spirit is faithful, and He will purify us through tribulation, whether it be now or during the last 7 years, the last 3.5 years, the worst tribulation His people have ever gone through in history. If you're around to see that, then know that it's for our purging, to make us white and clean. And you will instruct many and lead many to righteousness if you understand. That's what God declares at the end of Daniel. You will shine like the brightness of the stars forever. We will teach others and lead them to righteousness. How awesome is that? But you must open your mouth and go out your door. Wherever you can say it, say it. Teach God's people. Make new people for God. Bring more into the kingdom of light. Come against the kingdom of darkness. You have power over them. You have power over every demon on this earth. And they're everywhere, but they're powerless in the name of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit, the authority of God the Father. So, let's go take care of business. Be one with the family. We are one body in Christ, in Messiah. That's not something over there in Egypt. Why can't that happen in America and in England, Germany, Italy, South Africa, and Australia, Iran, Turkey? We're one body. Why can't you have a 10-minute worship session where all you do is say His name, shout His name in unison, united? I hope for that. I pray for that in my land and in every nation. Maybe it's going to take more tribulation and death and terror to bring us to that point. I kind of think it will take that. And unfortunately, I think we'll get to experience that. So please prepare, number one, your spirit. Get right with God. Let Him command you. Let Him tell you His will. Do His will, not your own, not self-preservation, but preparedness in His word, His spirit, worship in spirit and truth, and use your brain. Prepare for what's to come. Spiritually, your soul, that means you put your desires aside, make His desires paramount. And yes, even your flesh, it's not unbiblical or evil to have a stock of food or self-defense. Learn how to use it. Protect your family. Yeah, that's good. So prepare in all those ways. But you can't possibly prepare for what's to come if you don't know what is to come. God does know that, and he taught us that. So that's my ministry and the ministry of several others who I try to communicate with, and I encourage you to do the same. Get on board. Let's unite. Let's teach the truth about what's coming so we can be prepared. So when it does happen, we're not caught unawares, as the Bible would say, but that we know and we're awake and we have enough oil as a wise virgin, not the unwise who run out during the tribulation time, but that we have enough to the end. So we are invited to that wedding and we get to go in before the door is shut, and we'll be shut on fellow Christians, believers who couldn't deal with the stuff that's coming. I'm good. That's fine. Whatever happens, happens. I'm a pan tripper, you know? Whatever, however it pans out is fine with me. I'm ready for anything. Bull. That's the statement of the unprepared. So, again, I'm not talking about hiding in a bunker or prepping in a bug-out bag and all that. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about be smart, read the Bible, know what's coming, know that you have to be here. You're not getting raptured anywhere. If you die before the end, great. Don't seek martyrdom, right? You don't want to be murdered. But know that it's possible. Just do your what God tells you to do. You know he would never lead you wrong. You know he would never make you do anything evil. You know he would never have you break his commandments. So be sure of that. Have that surety in you. Go boldly out. Preach the gospel in season and out of season. Have an answer to every man. Every person who comes to you, be sure to witness to them. Cast out demons in his name. Deliver everyone around you who asks for it, who needs it. Find others who can help you get discipled if you don't feel up to it. You don't feel you're ready yet. That's okay. But at the same time, we don't have excuses. We have the ultimate power. We have the ultimate teacher. We have the ultimate healer already. So stay close with him. Talk to him every day. Get in your prayer closet. Spend time with him. Seek his will. Read his word. And Lord, I just want to send out a blessing now on everyone who's hearing this or seeing this. In the name of Yeshua, cover them with your Holy Spirit, Father. Give them a fresh anointing, Lord. Let them feel it in their flesh. And their responses, Lord, that they're feeling it right now. Pour over them to know that you are commissioning them, Lord. Commission them, Father. Send them out, Lord, as sheep amidst the wolves. Yes, but you are more than adequate. Your grace is sufficient, Lord. Send us out. Send them out to this world, into the field. Harvest, Lord. Produce the harvest. 30 or 60 or 100. Please, increase your kingdom through us, Lord. Anoint those who hear this in Jesus' name. Yeshua, the Anointed One. Our Messiah, we are one in him. Amen. Thank you, my friends. This has been Frontline. I'm Christopher Manti. Please feel free to communicate with me. Email here on CMVTV. Go to my website, ChristopherManti.com, Twitter, Manti4, YouTube channel, all the rest of it. I will see you next week, God willing. I love you. He loves you. He's got us in the palm of his hand, so it's very exciting. Stay in his will. And whatever comes, be faithful to whatever end.
Broadcasting on the shore. If you can fight, fight.
Can you hear me now?
there anyone out there hearing this?
Help each other. Be prepared for anything. Our war has just begun.